Welcome back to Hypnosis Today, where we explore how people are using hypnosis to achieve remarkable things. If you've just joined us, I have two very special guests for my second guest of the day. My first guest is Gila Zak. Now, she is an honors grad of HMI College of Hypnotherapy, and she is the first distance student ever to win the prestigious Director's Award. And she has with her her very special guest, Lisa. Lisa came in to see Gila for obsessive thoughts about food. Please help me welcome my guests. Lisa, I want to start with you. Tell me what was going on.
Since I was probably about 12, I had such anxiety about eating and how many calories things were, if I was going to gain weight. And things just started backfiring as I was getting older, and I couldn't handle it. I would wake up in the middle of the night, and it was just a constant fear of it. And I would just be like, oh my gosh, what did I eat? Or I ate too much. And it was just, it was exhausting.
It sounds exhausting.
It was really exhausting.
So I would think, how come you didn't go see a nutritionist?
So I actually did.
Really?
I was seeing a nutritionist for about a month, who's really amazing. And every time, she gave me a diet to follow, and I basically cut it in half. And I would just start crying every time I saw her. And she suggested that I see Gila and have hypnotherapy.
No, I love this. I love this. And I want to really commend you, Gila, for talking to other professionals who deal with people who have issues around habits or thoughts or intruding thoughts. And you made that connection with that nutritionist. And when there was someone you could help, that nutritionist sent that person to see you.
Yes.
So tell me, when someone has obsessive thoughts about food, what do we do?
Well, working within the scope of our practice as hypnotherapists, when someone is dealing with obsessive thoughts of any kind, but especially with body images, we look for the distortion. Where did the distortion get created that they have this image of themselves that really isn't real? And so we begin to reverse engineer that. We go backwards and say, where did this distortion come from? And then we clear it.
Did you find out where your distortion came from? You told me it started at 12. That's just around puberty. What was going on?
I think just I've had a troubled childhood, a lot of anxiety, and I think I focused all my energy onto food, so I didn't have to deal with it, and that was something that I can control when I was younger.
You know, with children, we exert so much influence on children. What we eat and where we put our waste is pretty much the only two things in our lives that we can control. And when things spin out of control, that's where the obsession comes. And once you realize that, were you a little bit relieved understanding about how it got set into motion?
Yeah, it's definitely, you know, it becomes a passing thought. It's just not a constant thing.
Of course. So now that we know where it came from, what next?
Well, at that point, we look to say, okay, the specific hypnosis I used with her was one that occurred to me that if she has this distorted self image of self, let's take her into a house of mirrors and talk to her about how distortions really aren't real. They're just a creation, a belief that was implanted that isn't even really yours.
Can you teach us how to go into a house of mirrors?
Of course, as long as no one has a fear of fun houses, we're good.
Yeah.
But essentially what we do is we walk in the front door and then you see the different various mirrors, and perhaps in one you can see yourself as, you know, 3 feet tall and 5 feet wide, and you find the humor in it. You see that it's really, how could that be? And then you see the next mirror, perhaps you're 12 feet tall and this wide, and you say, well, that just can't be. And so you just continue through until you get to the real mirror of how do you want to see yourself? I want to see myself as whole, beautiful. I have the client focus on the aspects of their body that they truly do like. And then they go in front of that mirror, and that's really all they tend to see and focus. The rest of the distortion falls away, and then we reinforce that through subsequent sessions or recordings.
What was that like for you? Could you see yourself in the funhouse mirror?
I could. It was funny, and I enjoyed it. So it really resonated with me. I don't know how it worked, but you know, after that, I just was like, I'm like, oh, okay, it's okay. And before, I would like have all these negative thoughts, and it went away.
So let's talk about some real-life things. You've talked about waking up in the middle of the night, focused on what did I eat, what didn't I eat, did I eat too much, did I eat too little, did I meet my needs, did I over-meet my needs? What happened for sleep after you visited Gila?
It was amazing, especially after the first session, is this peace has just come over me. And like I'll wake up in the middle of the night and it's okay. I'm like, you know what, I'm not thinking about this. And it's just like, and I fall back to sleep. But it's not really a passing thought, it's peaceful.
And so it's a wonderful, peaceful sleep, even if you wake up.
Right.
You can fall back asleep in peace.
Yeah, it's amazing.
What happens when it is mealtime? What goes on in your mind?
Yeah, I used to be very rigid about, I would like work out and I would go eat at the same place and I didn't want to change anything. And now I'm much more relaxed about it. If I miss a workout, I'm not freaking out about it. It's just, my life is just a lot easier. It's not so stressful. It's kind of nice.
And do you have a family? How has this impacted your family?
I do. I have a 5-year-old daughter and a husband. And, you know, I can appreciate things about them now. Before, I was so stuck in my own head that I couldn't, you know, just compliment them or have gratitude. And now I'm just much more happier. And I'm so thankful, you know, having a little girl, that I don't want her to have these issues.
Do you know what you're called, Lisa? You're called a transitional hero. I'll tell you what that is. You talked about having a very troubled childhood, and it's real easy when you have anxiety to pass that on to the next generation. A transitional hero is someone who makes the choice to get intervention to not pass the dysfunction onto the next generation, and that's really quite amazing. Talk to me about how we can teach our clients to talk to their children about food and body image.
I think it's really a question of, or the answer is really just be more aware. Just like she said, so much of our behavior, as we know, 95%, is coming from that subconscious place where we're really just not even aware of the things that are coming up and out. And in hypnosis, you create that window, that space, where your conscious, literal, intelligent mind becomes congruent with your subconscious belief patterns and vice versa. And so through that, you just naturally don't express those negative traits, and you're not acting out in the way that the child is going to model in the first place.
Absolutely. Yeah. So riding on that, building on that, you came in for hypnosis for food obsession. And what other way has hypnotherapy positively impacted your life?
So many aspects. Every time, like, I'm coming out of hypnosis, I always just think, like, I'm so excited to live life like this, to see what's going to be next, because it's just completely just changed things. It's not like such a cold, harsh place.
It's a safe, warm, good place.
Yeah.
How did you build in that sense of safety and fun and adventure?
Basically just reminding her how much control she really did have. I've kind of made it my personal mission to remind people how powerful they are. And so in essence, whether they've given over their power to a thought, a person, an experience, or a substance, they can take that power back. And I just like to re-educate people that no one really has any dominion, control, or authority over their thoughts, feelings, and behaviors. That belongs with the client. And so through hypnosis, we teach them to act that model and live it.
I love it. Now, you started having this issue when you were 12, and you're a beautiful young mother. Did you try anything else besides a hypnotherapist and a nutritionist?
I've actually been through therapy probably my whole life, and it really hasn't done much. There was one thing, I went the post-traumatic stress, and for 10 weeks I had to rewrite the same story and tell it over and over, and it was the most exhausting experience, and it helped that one experience, but that was it. And you know, just going to see Gila after one session was better than all those years.
How do you explain this?
Well, I think it speaks to her readiness and also to the model that we use. Her conscious mind said, you know, I want to act and feel different. I should act and feel different. And talk therapy certainly has its value. But it's in going into the subconscious mind that we can reframe something and take away that emotional punch that it has and make it something soft, make it something manageable. Yes. We reframe it and then replace it with something better.
It's interesting, as you had to tell your story over and over again, of course it released some of the pain of that story, but it also makes a little bit of a neural pathway. And your story becomes your story. Sometimes rewriting the story has an amazing effect in a full waking state. Is that what you found?
Oh, definitely. I can talk about things and it just not being a trigger. Like, I can sit here and say, you know, I grew up without a mom. She left when I was 2. But before, it would be such a trigger. It was almost like she rewrote the story.
Or you rewrote the story.
I rewrote the story. She helped me.
Tell me the new story. I want to hear at least. What's the new story about the person whose mother left when she was 2?
I am super grateful that she left, because my life has been so much better. I have a beautiful child, and if she stayed around, you know, I might have fallen into that and just been doing drugs and alcohol, and it saved me. And now, you know, I have this great daughter and family. It's amazing.
And that is your story. You're always recreating it. What did hypnosis feel like for you? Did you have any kind of a preconception about it?
I kind of asked her too, like, I just thought it would be like the end of yoga.
That's funny. The end of yoga. Tell me what you mean.
Just when you're laying down there and you're just so relaxed. And that's how I kind of felt like it was, but it was even deeper.
The end of yoga. You know, I have to say, Lise, that makes me laugh and tell me, let me tell you why. You are correct. It is like the end of yoga. Because at the end of yoga, everyone does a meditation, which is an alpha state that's slowing the brain waves down to from 12 to about 10, 9, 8. And hypnosis is also an alpha state. So yes, it is like the end of yoga, but a little bit deeper as you now direct it to positive change. Mm. What would you say for someone who has anxiety or obsessions around food or any kind of intruding thoughts about seeing a hypnotherapist?
That you're completely missing out if you don't go. I mean, for 20 years, I've been trying to do stuff and it wasn't working. And in one session, I had such a peace I can't even explain. It was kind of shocking, like how
surprising.
It happened.
Yeah. What would you say about working with Gila?
She's amazing. You know, half the time, I don't really know what's going on or what I need. And she can figure it out. And she's so helpful.
Yeah, well, the only reason that she can figure it out is she has the one thing you'll never have, objectivity when it comes to your life. And that's what's really cool about seeing a hypnotherapist, is we have someone with professional objectivity who is only a companion on your journey. And that's what makes it a really, really special relationship. It appears we're out of time for today, but I want to thank Lisa for coming in and talking about this very inspiring story. I want to thank Gila Zak for coming in and teaching us about how we can help people with intruding thoughts. And everybody is going to want to see Gila Zak. If someone's not in the greater Los Angeles area, do you also Skype or FaceTime?
Absolutely. I'll do. And I'm happy to travel. I live in the Central Coast, and I have lots of family in Los Angeles, so any excuse I get to come down here is fine with me.
How about doing Hypnosis TV? Is that a great reason
Absolutely.
To come down?
Absolutely. It's a fabulous reason.
Good. And you can reach Gila Zak on hmigrads.com. Thank you so much for being here. I want to thank everybody in the studio audience and those of you watching at home. But please stay tuned. We have a lot more coming up for you on hypnosistv.com.
Thank you.